Good news. We have another episode in the Azure Enablement Show in the Well-Architected Series. And in this episode, we're going to be talking to Dante about getting started with cost optimization, how to look at where and how to optimize your Azure spend. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we'll be discussing the challenges you and our other tech-savvy customers have encountered. Together, we'll be talking with experts to find out how they think about these problems, recommended tools and best practices, and tips they have learned from years of experience that you can use. So today, we're going to be talking a bit about cost optimization. And to bring you into the scene, what I'm going to do is I'm going to portray just your average customer, somebody who works at Tailwind Traders, a hardware company, and I've got a problem. So today I want to talk to my friend Dante, who is an expert in cost optimization, because I need some help. So Dante, here's the deal. I just had my CFO walk into my office brandishing our Azure bill and asking me like, what's going on and what can we do about it? So can you help me? How can I deal with this?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, happy to help, David. So this is not uncommon. Don't be alarmed. You know, this is something that we're here to help with, and we've got some guidance that I think can help you. And so I guess, first of all, what I'd love to find out from you is kind of, you know, where you're at and you know, where you're struggling and what are you having some trouble with? What's your CFO hoping to do?
So I think she is concerned about sort of the amount we're spending, whether we're getting the value for that amount of money, and also looking at our budget coming up for this year and whether we're spending it wisely. So
totally. Yeah, very, very common issue. So I think just to kind of get you started, and I think to kind of give you the lay of the land, I want to show you something, these few different stages that you could, so to help you kind of think about cost optimization and the sorts of things you might want to do at different stages of your kind of Azure journey. And so first up, there's this stage, which is the design stage. And that's right at the beginning when you're developing a new workload, conceptualizing it, determining what are your business requirements, what can it cost, you know, what are your requirements along the lines of reliability and performance, what kind of business value do you need it to deliver for you. So that's kind of the early stage of design. And of course, there's things you can do at that stage right at the beginning that are best practices that'll help you ensure that you're cost efficient all the way through. Next up, there's this step of provisioning, which is where you're actually, you know, you're going to the you know, the different building blocks and picking them out and setting them up so that you kind of build your workload. And this is where you start to actually build it out. And then once it's running in the cloud, there's this step of monitoring, which is where, you know, you want to keep tabs on how it's being used, what you're spending, and just constantly reviewing internally with the right stakeholders to make sure that everything's happening that you want to be happening with this particular workload. And then lastly, there's this step of optimization, which I think is one that people think about most frequently when they think about the topic of cost optimization. But you'll see it only comes at the end because there's a lot of things you can do up front to help you along the way, ensure you kind of are still in a good position at the end. But this step is really about what are the things you can do now that it's running to make it run more cost efficiently. To make it, you know, make sure that it's kind of appropriately sized and delivering on business value, but at the right level for you. So does that kind of make sense, those different stages?
Yeah, it totally does. And I think just because we're talking about an existing workload that I have, mm-hmm. I think I want to be like everybody else, and I kind of want to start at the end. Even the other ones look really cool too. So let's talk a little bit about sort of monitoring, or even start with optimizing, where you think is a good place to start.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that sounds good. And you know, there's a lot of things you can learn from doing that with your existing workloads, or maybe you've made some mistakes that then you can bring back into earlier stages of design and development too. So there's one thing else I'd like to show you as well that I think is going to help you. And you know, there's a lot that you can do, of course, that are really impactful things along the lines of monitoring and optimizing your existing workloads. And we've got a bunch of guidance that I'll definitely be sure to share with you that you can go more into depth. But if to just to high level it, so that these are some high impact techniques that you really need to know up front. And you'll see that a lot of the different tactics that you end up implementing fall into these different kind of buckets. So first of all, there's this important idea of increasing cost awareness and visibility and accountability. And this is really about just getting your arms around what are you spending, why are you spending it, who's spending it, all that kind of stuff. And so this is things like setting up budgets for your workloads, assigned to your different teams, setting up alerts against those budgets so that you're getting notified if costs are getting out of control or are approaching some kind of a limit. Also tagging your resources so that you know whose resource this is, who it belongs to, what it's for, how important it is, all those kinds of things. So are you doing any of those kinds of things today with your workloads?
Yeah, I'm a little embarrassed to say we're definitely doing some of the budget things. I think we're also doing some of the tagging, but not in any sort of consistent way. And that's something I definitely have to work on.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it's a great way to start. And I mean, this really falls into that kind of monitoring phase, getting that right. But it's often really foundational for the optimize phase, which I imagine is the one that's going to ultimately give your CFO what they're looking for there. And so when you start to get into optimize, the things that you're going to start to do are around, especially around eliminating cloud waste. Because a lot of this is a little bit of a new habit for people who might be used to kind of on-prem, where some of these things are not necessarily as relevant. And so there's these concepts of things like shutting down unused resources. It's very common for there to be cloud sprawl and for there to be dev environments that are running in the background that you didn't realize were running all the time, or might be for a project that has expired and so on. There's also the idea of right-sizing resources to a really appropriate size, because you're paying, of course, exactly based on that size. So the closer you can fit your workload sizes and your resource sizes to kind of the actual demand and usage you're seeing, the better off you're going to be from a cost perspective. And likewise, there's functionality that cloud provides around auto scaling and auto shutdown that you can use to make sure that you're being as efficient as possible, which is often what this is about. So does this make sense? Are these some things that you're looking at today?
Yeah, totally. I mean, we've done a little bit of scaling. I would say that, like the previous answer, we're not consistent on all those things. Like we're not doing any sort of shutting down, which is something I think we should look at.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah, and I think the other thing to point out about this is that we carefully call it cloud waste, because the idea here is that it's not necessarily, I mean, unfortunately for your CFO, ultimately you are going to end up spending some money on the cloud. But the key is avoiding waste. You want to only spend what you need to spend. And in some cases, if it's a very important workload and it's mission critical, it's worth investing in it up to the appropriate level of your business requirements. And that's why so much of this comes back to, what do you need? What do you need from a reliability, a performance, all that kind of those kinds of perspectives? And that'll help you determine what you kind of need to spend. Does that make sense?
Yep. Awesome. I'm following you.
Awesome. Great. Next up is, it's important to take advantage of all the different offers and licensing advantages that Azure provides. Two really big ones, the Azure Hybrid Benefit, which helps you extend your on-prem investments already in licensing around Windows Server and SQL Server, and now also Linux subscriptions to Azure in some cases. And you can see some really significant savings there. So that's a great one to take advantage of, because, of course, I'm sure you, like many others, have large on-prem investments already. Yeah. And then reservations is great because it allows you to kind of make a commitment over a longer period of time, like a year or 3 years. And then you save against the pay-as-you-go rate for that service. And so those are great things. And often those are ones that you'll want to look at in kind of partnership with your central IT team, because a lot of times they're going to be the ones who manage those. So that could be a great one to bring to your CFO and then also to bring to central IT when you talk to them.
Okay.
All right. And then lastly, this one's a little more challenging. That's why we put it last. But if you're open to it, it can be really important to take a look at your architecture for your workloads and explore kind of these PaaS and serverless options that you have available, because there can be situations where it really lowers a lot of the TCO associated with the total cost of ownership associated with a given workload, because it avoids a lot of the kind of management that you need to do at the more IaaS level when you're working with things like VMs. And so it's a great thing to consider. And we have, like with any of these, what we're talking about now, we have a lot of guidance that we can share with you to help make those decisions a little bit more palatable. And then you can approach the idea of modernizing and moving to more of a cloud-first design. for the cost benefits there.
Yeah, so it sounds like the next step for me, Dante, is to talk to somebody at Microsoft to get a handle on what's actually going on in my situation. Do you know anybody who can help me with that?
Yeah, absolutely. I've got a colleague named Tanuja, and she's incredibly experienced and expert in all things cost optimization. So she can certainly help you, and I'm sure she'd be very happy to set up some time with you and look into this stuff a little more deeply.
Okay, cool. And so I look reasonable when I talk to her. Would you be so kind as to send me an email with that, with her contact and maybe like some things I should read up ahead of time?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I'll send you an email right away, and I'll include some links in there to a couple resources like the cost optimization part of the Azure Well-Architected Framework. I think that'd be particularly valuable to you. You can take a look at the monitor guidance, the optimized guidance, anything else you want to check out in there too, and then you'll be all ready to talk to Tanuja.
Cool. Well, I think I'm going to be talking to Tanuja in the next video. So let me switch back to host mode. Cool. Well, I want to thank you all for joining me. I hope that you'll join me in the next video. We'll find out what happens to me when I go talk to Tanuja. Thank you very much, and look forward to seeing you in the next video.